Hey everyone, today we're going to be looking at the Ensoniq ESQ-1. This is a wavetable synthesizer that came out in 1985. It's something that I've wanted for a while now. I finally was able to acquire one cheap that needs a little bit of repair here, but it does work. I powered it on and it powers up. Every key is working, you get sound out of everything. A few minor issues with it. First is the battery's dead, no big deal. I don't really care about that. The second part is that the voice control over here on the right is damaged. So I'll do a closer screenshot so you can see that. So I don't know if something hit it or what, but all the buttons are pushed in. Some are missing. I believe they're inside. There's some things rattling around inside the synth when I shake it. So I kind of shook it to the right to get them all down to the right here. So hopefully I can grab them all out of the bottom. So I got to look into that. But in terms of all the rest of the buttons here, they all do seem to work, including the couple I can push here. So I don't think there's any cracked boards, but we'll take a look at that anyway. But as I mentioned, every key works. I hooked up the audio. I've got audio out on every key. So the key bed's good. I've just got to look into the issue with there. And then we'll take a look at replacing the battery. We will then go through and kind of do a mini teardown. I'm really curious to see what circuitry is making this work. Because wavetable synths are actually really neat. You don't see a lot of them today. It was kind of a thing popular in the 80s. The most famous being the PPGs that actually were wavetable synths. This synth is more closely comparable to like the Kawai K3, which was also wavetable synth. The difference is that this one's, I think, a slightly more powerful. You've got three oscillators, you've got three LFOs, you've got 32 different waves that you can select, you know, per each oscillator. The way that it works is basically all your waves are stored in ROM, and it's basically a lookup table, almost like a direct digital synthesis type system where, you know, it'll read the wave stored in ROM and convert that to analog waveforms, and then you pass it through truly analog filters. So a lot of people like these synths because you get a lot of that kind of, you know, digital harshness if you want it from the oscillators, but you still have these really nice analog filters to filter your sounds through. So we will begin by opening up, taking a look inside, seeing if I can figure out what's going on with the front controls here, and then we'll start looking at the rest of it. So working on these older synths is always really nice because they're designed to be repairable. On the ESQ-1, like a lot of older synths, you've got four screws here on the front, and this entire front panel flips up and gives you access to all the electronics inside. So it's really, really nice. Nice engineering, nice design of these. You don't have to rip them apart like a lot of the later, you know, 90s gear that I've worked on. Once those four screws are removed, the front simply pops up. And you have access to the hole inside, which is really, really nice. So we'll take a closer look later in the video, but power supply here, all your main circuitry here for the actual synthesis, and then your front panel, which contains your big display. It's a really nice VFD, and then your control button structure. But this is what I'm interested in over here. So two things I noticed straight away. One, something definitely spilled in here. There's a kind of a sticky splash underneath the key bed where it was covered by the front panel here that whoever had done whatever wasn't able to clean this. So it's somewhat concerning, but not really, because I know every key works, so at least it hasn't gotten down and damaged anything that's prevented it from working now. I'm still going to clean it up and probably remove these keys and take a look underneath to see what's there. Secondly, the front panel here that's broke. If you look, you can see it's actually, something's pressed, my guess is something pressed hard enough on these buttons to actually break the little front panel pieces here away from the front panel that actually hold the board in place. And that's why some of those buttons have fallen out, and actually the buttons are down here in the front. So it's like there's four of them down there, which is I think how many are missing, which is good. So I have all those. So I'm going to have to drop this whole front panel, which doesn't look too bad at all. So I will pull that off, and then we can reinsert those buttons. And I'm going to have to epoxy these plastic pieces on. I'll have to see what I have. I'm going to have to do something. I mean, I don't plan on, I don't know what type of plastic this is exactly. It looks like some type of something that's glass reinforced, but I'll see what epoxy I have that is good for plastics that I can glue on there so that it'll hold that in place and hopefully not break again if I'm pushing these buttons. just massive, beautiful VNC display. So there's the two sliders in the front for volume and data entry, and I can't get them off the shafts of the linear pots. Like, I've pulled pretty hard trying to pry them off there, and I'm worried I'm going to damage the actual slide potentiometers themselves by putting more force on them. So I'm not going to remove this entire front panel. I can gently bend it away from the side and get to all the buttons I need to get to. So I'm going to do that, just the risk of not damaging this thing any further than it already is. Prop the front of this up too, and some foam just to kind of tilt the back a little bit further, so that when I pull this away, the buttons, no more of the buttons continue to fall out than necessary. So the mystery is starting to explain itself as to why that front panel is broken. As I'm pulling these buttons off the front panel there, they too are sticky with residue from pop or something that was spilled on this, which is starting to make me think these buttons were sticking down, which required, you know, whoever owned this to put a lot more force on them to try to make them work, which probably broke the front panel. My best guess, anyway. So I'm going to have to clean all these buttons on this side of it, which isn't a big deal. I can access them all pretty easily here. All the yellow buttons have the same problem as well. They're just nasty. So I'll clean all those too. So I've got the buttons clean, and I've got them replaced back in the front panel here. Not all firmly screwed in, just kind of holding there in place right now. The reason being is because I'm missing one. I have no idea where it went. I thought I had them all. I thought I counted that. I thought I had the correct count. I am short one, though. I've looked everywhere. I dropped a couple. I picked them up. I don't think I dropped them on the floor. I've been looking everywhere for it. The only thing I can think is that there's still one inside this case somewhere that's wedged somewhere, so I'm going to have to dig around in here and look for it. Yeah, it kind of sucks. But anyway, so we'll do that next. We'll kind of take a look. I'll pull this panel off here and see what's underneath it, because I'm really curious of what's running the synth. All right, metal cover's removed, and good news, here is my last push button. So I wasn't going crazy. I didn't lose it. It's right there. It was just stuck behind the battery. Bad news, two things. One, the battery's already been replaced. It's kind of a hack job in there, so that's not great. It doesn't look like it's been leaking too much, but it'll be fine. Second problem is this board is actually much bigger than I assumed. It is pretty much underneath the entire heatbed in this area here, which means everything interesting we can't see because it's way underneath here. So I got to look and see if there's an easy way to get this keybed off. I was really hoping I didn't have to remove the keybed, but I'm here. I want to see it, so I'll see if I can pull it off real quick. All right, there's about 12 or so screws in the bottom holding the keybed, and then there's another handful of screws on this panel, which you have to remove first, as I just need to set it aside, and that allows me to lift, kind of slide and shift the keybed out, so I can retrieve it. Set this aside. And now we have access to the main board, which is interesting looking, so let's take a peek. So the circuitry in the ESQ-1 is pretty cool. I really want to talk into detail about what's going on here. You've got some classic analog chips and some really interesting digital stuff going on. In terms of saving time, I'll probably make a separate video that talks about the internals to the ESQ-1. The one thing I will mention is this group of chips over here. These are the CEM3379s. These are basically analog chips. They're audio signal processors. And this contains the VCAs and the VCFs for the synthesizer. Since this is an 8-voice, you know, polyphonic synthesizer, you've got one dedicated to each of those voices. So these are essentially your filters. They're four-pole filters that, you know, provide your cutoff and your resonance. Very common chips for the era. You would see these in a lot of different synths at the time, and they're pretty common, and they sound really, really good. So this is providing your cutoff and resonance in the ESQ-1. Third week A6, let's see, 34th week A6, 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 A6. There might be some earlier in here, but everything I've seen is 86. quick look at the power supply, just because it is pretty interesting. Straight up linear supply, so input here, you've got nice input filtering on your actual IEC connector, which is good. Then you've got a nice big transformer made by ACEM in Italy, which is interesting, so dated 87. From there, you got your secondary feeding to this, basically the power supply board here, where you've got multiple fuses for all the input, which is nice. You're gonna have, you know, you'll have multiple analog or your AC voltages coming off that transformer to feed your regulators here. So, no rectifiers; they're just doing it with diodes. They got a couple sets in here, which is fine. And then they have it easily labeled. Here's your analog supply: your positive and negative 12 with your 79 or 7812 positive, 7912 negative. And then there's two 7805s here snuck back. So my guess is one's driving the analog, one's driving the digital circuitry. Besides that, just all your required filtering capacitors. Let's see, they look to be Nippon Chemicons, and that's a Nishikon, so nice caps in here. Being that this is made in Japan, it's not unexpected. They look all to be 85C rated. So, good quality caps. They are old. I'm going to probably replace them at a later date here anyway, just because there's not that many, and why not? They're going to go bad at some point. Might as well just do it before they do go bad. All the actual regulators are tied to this little piece of steel in the back here, which actually has a heatsink on the very back. So I'll show a picture of that. So I don't know how hot this gets. I've only had it on for a handful of minutes, but it obviously got warm enough to warrant that, you know, heatsink be in there. I mean, there is a lot of logic on this board, and this stuff is all 74F. There's some 74LS, some 4000 series CMOS in there. That's a 74LS. So on the digital board, it's power hungry TTL. So the LS stuff was supposed to be a little bit more power efficient, but you know, there's some 74F stuff in here which, you know, draws some serious current. So I wouldn't be surprised if, you know, this board was definitely drawing an amp or more, you know, per rail for that matter. All right, with the synth all back together, I want to test this battery real quick and just see if there's anything left in it. And it is completely dead. Alright, so I'm just going to cut it out. I don't have that size replacement available at the moment. I'm going to have to order one. But it's not doing anything in there now. And the only thing it is going to do is leak. So, the previous person that replaced it had just cut it off the top of the board like I just did anyway. Which isn't ideal, but I don't blame them. To rip all this apart, take the board out just to replace the battery properly from the bottom is a huge amount of work compared to, you know, just easily cutting leaves and soldering it on there. I am going to clean up those traces, though. There's a little bit of nastiness on there. It's potentially just solder flux from whoever had replaced it previously, but I just want to make sure it's not battery acid. So it's easy to get to that. I'll just replace that once I have it in. There's nothing to it. You just soldered the new one in. Up here, I did go ahead and epoxy the. I found some epoxy that was good for most plastics. I'm not exactly sure what plastic, the type of plastic this is. Can't find any markings on it either, but it doesn't matter. I glued the stands on the three that were broken, and I put pressure on it, held it for a couple minutes just until it set. It was a two-part epoxy that you mix, and then I've got some tape here, just kind of putting it under stress, holding it on there. I'll leave it for about an hour or so until it fully sets. At that point, I should be good. Last thing I need to do is just drop this metal plate back in, and then really just clean it. I already cleaned some of that nasty that was off of here. I pulled one of these keys off too. You just pull the spring off the back here, and you can kind of slide it forward and look in. And you know, there's a little bit of gunk sitting in between the keys inside here, but it's not that bad. I don't think it's going to hurt anything, so I'm not going to bother ripping this entire keybed apart to get to that. One other interesting note is all the electrolytics on the main board are axial, which is strange, at least some of them are, but they are 105C rated, which is nice. So they actually spent the money for the little bit better components at the time for the actual audio circuitry, which is good to see. Before I throw this back together, I just wanted to show a close-up of that display. It's a VFD, and it's just massive. It's 2-line by 40 character. You never see anything like this in electronics anymore. I mean, this is an expensive display. It's a power-hungry display, but it's just beautiful. It's one of the really, really neat things about this synth. All right, I've got the tape on here. I'm still letting that epoxy sit a little bit longer. In the meantime, I'm just kind of working on cleaning it up a little bit. It's in pretty good shape overall, but it just really needs a good deep clean. So I had the front panel out and those buttons out, I was able to clean the back pretty well in terms of around the buttons and stuff like that. And hit the keyboard pretty good too. Still needs a little bit more work on that. But once it's done being cleaned, it'll look pretty good, I think. The bottom of it too, I didn't show any video of it, but it's extremely clean too. Typically when you have a synth that somebody moves around a lot, like they actually play live with it, the bottom gets all really scratched up. Just from, you know, transportation, putting it on stand, taking it off a stand, etc. This one's really clean. The bottom doesn't look very damaged at all. It's actually in really, really good shape. Along with the rest of this too, there's really no big dents or dings or anything. So this is probably more of a studio unit. Again, no idea the history of it, no idea who had it before me or how many owners there were. But it's definitely in need of some care to get it back into good working condition. So I've got the ESQ-1 back assembled on the bench. I'll put back together. And powering up, we look to be good in terms of everything coming on. In terms of all the buttons actually working now too, which is nice. So all the oscillators, all the actual DCAs, all the LFOs, envelopes, every function on here works, which is nice. There is one problem though. So the data entry slider, I mentioned earlier in the video, I was worried I was going to break it because I really had to pry on this knob to get it off. Well, I did break it. So it's no longer, if you watch the envelope 3 here on the first L1 variable, you can see I move it just a little bit and it jumps all the way down to the lowest value and then it stays there for the rest of the slide. So most likely I cracked the actual PCB inside the pod itself on the carbon wipe, so it will need to be replaced. So I was really mad at myself about that, but again, these must be glued on because I've never experienced a slider like that difficult to replace. So a few days have gone by and actually I ordered replacement parts. I've got two potentiometers there. I ordered two because chances are as I try to take the knob off of this one, if I do the same with volume, I'm probably going to break that as well. And they're both the same pot between the two on there. So I ordered both of these from a company called Syntaur, S-Y-N-T-A-U-R. This company is awesome for locating vintage parts for vintage synth, or new parts, I should say, for vintage synth, some new old stock, some actually new. Now, granted, I could take these, you know, pots out, the actual, you know, sliders, and spend some time on DigiKey or Mouser going through the parametric search and try to match them up. But you go to the site, they have them right there. They're not expensive. They've already figured out exactly what part you need to replace it in here. So there's no real need for me to spend the time trying to research it. So both of these are very nice potentiometers. They have a really nice feel to them. So really, really smooth. They'll feel really nice compared to the two that are in here that kind of have a grungy, you know, they just feel dirty, even though they're not, they're old. So it'll be a nice replacement to replace both of these within the unit. The downside is I need to take it all back apart. So I will start on that and get the main boards out. One thing I failed to mention earlier in this video too, there was actually two revisions of the ESQ-1. The earlier models were actually made out of metal. The entire chassis was metal, it wasn't plastic. And then the later ones that came out were plastic like this one, the one I have here. So I don't know if one is technically better than the other. You know, the metal does look nice because it's metal and has a nice feel to it. But this plastic is a very thick, you know, constructed plastic. So it is a very nice material on these too. Just something to note if you're ordering parts for the ESQ-1 is that there'll be different parts depending on, you know, what the actual function is of the unit for the earlier metal version or the later plastic version. So removing these caps over these linear, off these linear pots, I'm going to try an IC puller and see if I can get up underneath there and pull it, because I don't want to pry it. I don't want to damage the plastic underneath this resin. I don't want to damage the actual slider itself. So we'll see if this has any better success. At this point, I don't care if I break the pots anymore because I've got the replacements. So I'm just going to do my best to get it out without damaging anything further. Man, they're just on there. Well, it moved though, so that's a good sign. Jeez. Yeah, I don't want to pull so hard I break the board underneath either, but there we go. So there is the first one that's off, and it's all right. I'll take a small foul of that edge there and just clean it up, because I did put a couple little nicks in it. I'll try the volume pot now. It's equally as hard. I think I just heard that pot crack in there. There it goes. Alright. Alright, time to remove those. Note that this is a huge board, single-sided, but still, it's an expensive board to produce that size. Anyway, here is my two linear potentiometers, and there's my replacements, and they do indeed look like a perfect match. So, time to replace those. You can see how it is damaged as well, right there, from pulling up on it. The board is cracked right at that leg, unfortunately. So. Again, stupid mistake by me, but to get those off, I didn't really have much other choice. So one thing I noticed about the replacement pots I have is that here's the old one, here's the new one. The new one has these additional stress pins. So these pins aren't electrically tied to anything. They're just this piece of metal that's part of the structure that's crimped into the whole body of this that has two more pins that can be soldered to the board. What this does is give you a little bit extra stress relief on the entire pot itself for the reason I just had. So if I'm putting upward pressure on it, the body of it is taking the force of that, and it's putting most of the resistance to these pins, not the pins on the end, which are only tied to, you know, the PCB, which ultimately in my case is, you know, where it failed, where it cracked. So now, granted, there's not holes on the board for that to be used, but they're there if you were using this in a new design. So for me, I'm just going to have to bend those pins out of the way. So new linear potentiometers are in, and we should be good. This board was tested and declared okay in 1986. Okay, all back assembled, and we are good. The potentiometers feel really nice, and they're actually operating properly now, so happy with that. So, got two things left to do on this. First is I'm going to replace the battery, which, while I waited for the potentiometer to come in, the battery I needed actually came in too. I have it here. So we'll put that in. And then I had second thoughts. I am going to replace all the capacitors on the power supply. The power supply comes out really easily, and I'm not going to feel right unless I do it. And if I don't do it now, it's just going to bug me later. So I'm going to do it now, get it done, and then we won't have to worry about that. I am not going to do the capacitors at this time on the main logic board because those are 105C rated. I've got a little bit higher confidence that they're okay at this point. And also they're axial. I don't have any axial caps. That are 105C rated as well. So if I put any radial caps in there, it would just be kind of a hack job, which I'm not going to do right now. So I will leave those alone, but I will replace everything on the power supply. I need to remove the keypad again to get that out, of course. Comes out easy now. So like I mentioned before, they used good caps. There's a mixture of Nippon Chemicon and Nishikon in here. But they're not 105C rated, and they've been in here since around 1986. So here is the freshly recapped power supply. I replaced every electrolytic on here that was existing with Panasonic, mostly the EUFC series of electrolytics that they have. These are really high quality capacitors, rated 105 C Celsius. Forget the endurance, 3,000 or 5,000 hours, I can't remember exactly offhand, but really good cap. So replaced everything on here, including, you know, all the small ones along the back here. And there were a couple that were leaking, so I'm actually glad I did this, because a couple of smaller ones, and then these 470 at 63 volts were getting kind of gross as well. And a couple of these smaller Nippon Chemicons were leaking as well. So I'm glad I did this. I'd recommend it for any of these ESQ-1s, you know. It's going to need them. That is it for that rebuild, so reinstall this and reassemble the unit, and we should be done. So one last note on the keybed. I decided to go ahead and take it apart just because it just didn't seem right. A couple of the keys felt a little sticky, which I knew that there was some additional pop or whatever had spilled on this down there too. So I started taking the keybed apart. You do that by pulling these springs off the back here, and then once that's done, you actually have to lift. I'll show the mechanism on the bottom. It's really neat. They don't use your typical carbon pressure pads like most synths do. It's actually a thin metal spring that when the key goes down, it switches position from an upper lever down to a lower lever, which is kind of unique. Some older synths did this. It's not uncommon. It's nice because it's usually less maintenance because you don't have to worry about carbon contacts going dirty. Anyway, you have to disconnect that from the bottom, and then the keys themselves can lift up, and you can see how nasty these keys are. So whatever was stuck on the side is just all over inside here. So I'm going to be pulling probably the section all the way down to probably the next C here just to clean this out, because it is really, really nasty. Okay, this looks to about cover the section in terms of what was dirty. So the keys themselves are all cleaned up. They're looking nice. I cleaned up in here. I got a little bit more cleaning to do too. For those that are curious, these keys are weighted. There's a little weight on the white keys there, and on the black keys you can see it screwed in there as well. So they definitely have a nice feel to them. But I'm going to just finish cleaning this, reassemble this, and then we should actually be good. We can reassemble the whole synth. So I have ESQ-1 reassembled, not completely. I've still got to put some screws in here. I've got the metal cover in here, stuff like that. But it's good enough now to test. So powering it on. It does power on. The battery warning is gone now as well, since we put a new battery. And looks like we're good. So I've gone through the ESQ-1 completely, tested every button, tested every function. Everything seems to be working great. So this will really conclude this repair of the Ensoniq ESQ-1. I hope this video was beneficial to you, not only for the ESQ-1, but for the SQ-80 as well, which came out after the ESQ-1. It is very similar in construction to the ESQ-1. So, thanks for watching.